Up to this point in our discussion of computer architecture, we've been focusing mainly on the computational components. So today we're going to turn our attention to looking more deeply into the memory side of things. So these are the topics we're going to cover, and let's go ahead and dive right in. So we've been sort of referring to memory as something of a black box. We've talked a little bit about flip-flops and how they might play a role in this. But in reality, modern computer systems actually have a variety of memory types called a memory hierarchy. And the idea is that we're going to have smaller pools of faster memory that are located closer to the CPU, and those are going to hold the data that is more frequently accessed. And then we're going to have other levels that are increasingly further from the CPU that are increasingly slower but also cheaper so that we can make them larger. And each level is going to cache data from the next lower level, which means that it kind of stores a copy of the data that's needed at any given point. So the goal here, the reason that we do this, is so that we essentially have a large general pool of memory that kind of performs almost as if it was all made of the fastest memory. But of course, it's less expensive because we don't actually have to build it all out of the fastest memory. It turns out the fastest memory is, of course, the most expensive kind to manufacture. So there are some key concepts here, including locality of time and space, and we're going to return to this in a couple of different places. Some other useful distinctions that we'll make along the way are volatile versus non-volatile, which refers to volatile memory will lose its values if it loses power, whereas non-volatile will not. And then we'll also talk about random access versus sequential access. Some types of memory suffer no performance penalty to access locations that are different every single time. That's random. That's referred to as random access, although it's not really random, it's just sort of arbitrary access. But then there are some memory types that do better when you're accessing locations in sequence, one after the other. And so we refer to those types of memory as sequential access. So here's a graphical depiction of the memory hierarchy, and you can see here at the very top we have a couple of layers that are very close to the CPU. In fact, they're normally on the CPU chip. And these are typically made of expensive but very, very fast memory. And so you have the registers, which are in the register file, and then you have several levels of SRAM caches. We'll define SRAM here in a minute. And so those all live very close to the CPU they sort of serve as a buffer that allow the CPU very fast access to the things that it's currently working on. And then as we get further from the CPU, we have memory types that are cheaper, so that we can build more of them, but they are slower. And so we have main memory, which is something called DRAM, which we'll talk about in a minute. And then, of course, we have secondary storage, like the hard drives, and remote secondary storage, like web servers or distributed file systems.